Okay, Paul, I'd like to start with some comments from you about working on location. How do you manage to get close to these fishermen and traders when you obviously wish to disrupt the manta trade? The people you meet do not seem to be suspicious of you. Weren't they afraid that you would present them with in an unflattering light?
Obviously, every situation is very different, but over the years, I think I've just got quite used to being able to read people's body language. And even though you're going into an intense situation or a hostile environment, you can sort of play it down with your body language. And you know, body language really says a lot about people. And normally I can sort of work around the situation where they allow me access. Worst case scenario, I'll just go in and take photographs and normally, you know, ask for forgiveness. Basically, it's better to beg for forgiveness and ask for permission, because normally they'll shut you down anyway. So always, like I said, it just depends on the situation.
I mean, if you're seeing an event that really upsets you, like a real ill treatment to a creature, do you keep your emotions just under control and keep shooting, or how do you handle that?
Yeah, for sure. I totally just switch off and keep shooting, even though there's times where you want to sort of, you know, stop, throw your cameras aside and put that fish back in the ocean or do what you can to protect it. But there's no point at that stage. It's not going to change the situation. If anything, it's going to escalate, and then it's going to, you know, shut down access for me to continue further working. So it's better to just try and document, capture the truth, capture what's going on, and then go forward from there. And then it's normally after you get back from the shoot, you start editing the pictures. That's when you start to reflect. That's when you do get some emotions coming back when you sit down the end of the day or end of the shoot and reflect on it.
Do you have a particular memorable experience you can share with us about that? Any particular incident that sticks with you?
I think it was in one particular incident, 2012 in the Indian Ocean on the Rainbow Warrior. We were boarding a longliner in, I think it was just off the coast of Mauritius somewhere, trying to document a longlining catch. And we got on board, they allowed us on board, which was cool. We spent a couple of hours and they started bringing up these blue sharks. And you could see some of these blue sharks were alive, but also they were pregnant. And they started cutting open the sharks, you know, definning the sharks and then gutting the sharks and processing them, basically cutting the heads off. It's pretty gory stuff. But then when you're seeing these baby sharks being cut open and then hitting the deck for the first time and trying to swim, because they're obviously mature enough, you know, they're obviously weeks or days away from being born, and seeing them trying to swim on the decks and knowing those, you know, those small sharks are never actually going to hit the ocean or never get to do what they should do. It was just, situations like that are really, really, it's quite soul destroying because, you just can't do anything.
You come closer to animals than most people. You're confronted with the horrible treatment humans do to animals and nature on a regular basis. You encounter disastrous environmental destruction. Do your images ever follow you into your dreams?
Yeah, over the years, I have photographed some pretty depressing situations and also some very beautiful moments with wildlife. But over time, you sort of look back and I have a bit of a, I suppose from time to time, a bit of a negative outlook on the future of a lot of these species we coexist with. But at the same time, I'm very hopeful. And still, there's great opportunity to get it right with a lot of these species we share the planet with. But yeah, there's times where sort of every now and again you hit a bit of a wall, and it does get you down a bit. And sometimes you feel like it'd be great to just be able to hide your head in the sand and not even think about these issues. But once you cross a line, it's hard to sort of look away. Well, maybe some people do, but I can't. And I can't just sort of once you've seen the truth, you can't just leave it or not acknowledge it and not actually try to expose it and bring it out, just inform people with that information about those species, because they can't really stand up and do it themselves. So I think, yeah, there's times it gets me down, but what do you do? Just keep on soldiering on, kind of thing, you know? But I am very hopeful. We can't lose hope.
Project Manta Ray of Hope is a joint initiative that includes top field investigators, leading scientists and researchers, all working together to further the conservation of mantas and mobula rays. On that project, you're one of the people in charge. Did Project Manta Ray of Hope have an effect? Is it completed as far as you are concerned?
I think it had a huge, huge effect. When it started, I was sort of, the sort of lead investigator in China following the gill trade. And at the time, there was no information on the gill trade in Guangzhou or the volume. So it was. I spoke to several scientists and no one was really working in China. No one had any funding for that. I just started going up to China and collecting samples, photographing as I went. So we pretty much, over time, put together a very comprehensive study on the manta and mobula gill ray trade in China. And in 2011, we put a report out, The Global Threat of Manta Rays and Mobula Rays, in collaboration with Shark Savers and Wild Aid at the time. In 2013, mantas were listed under CITES in Appendix 2. So I think through the work we actually did and the gill ray trade, really helped them get listed in at CITES. So yes, I think it was very successful and still ongoing now. It's still moving forward. Now we're also focusing on the biggest manta ray fishery in the world, which is in Lamakera, which is in the Solo Islands in Indonesia. We're actually now working with the village of over 3,500 villages to help them convert from a manta ray fishery to a more sustainable pole and line fishery and ecotourism. As a photographer, there'll be still images needed just to show the beauty of the location. We've got a tagging program, so we'll be documenting villages tagging manta rays, but also I'll be working alongside helping that transition in a number of areas. Yeah, this road is very long, and this is sort of just the beginning.
Okay, Paul. Thank you very much for talking to us.
No worries. Thank you.